Thanks for joining us at Calvary Baptist Church today for our evening service. And we hope that today's message will be a blessing to you. And we're going to start our service off with a word of prayer and then a great old hymn of the past, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you and we are so grateful to come into your presence. And Lord, I pray that if there's someone who's listening by way of internet today who doesn't know you as personal Lord and Savior, that today that they would turn to you in repentance and faith and ask you to forgive them and save their souls. And so, Father, I thank you so much that you are merciful to the thousands, to the millions and the billions, and that there's not one soul who you can't save. So, Father, I ask that you would have your will and your way today and take your word and shine your hot white light down upon us and cause us to know your truth. And Lord, we know that the truth will set us free. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you sing with me this great hymn of the faith, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, tune my heart to sing thy praise.
Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flame above. Praise his name, I'm fixed upon it, the name of God's redeeming love. Hitherto thy love has blessed me, thou hast drawn me to this place, and I know safely home by thy good grace. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger bought me with his precious blood.
Is my heart
Oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
Thanks for joining us for the fourth in our series on destiny. Now, today we'll talk about modified destiny, and we'll continue this series to extend it to a few more weeks, actually, because I feel that the need is very great for us to understand about how God views our destiny. Nurse, who's in full protective equipment, they have the ID badge, a stethoscope, it's legitimate, and they have a note for you from NHS to say that you need to be rushed to A&E straight away because you have COVID-19. And you think, wait a minute, I feel perfectly fine. Why do I need to be rushed to A&E? Well, they continue to say, there's some bad news. Your test results came back as positive for COVID-19. And even though it's in the early stages, in the incubation, if nothing is done, the results will be deadly. And that reminds me that most of us don't think that a different problem is so bad because we feel quite fine about it. We don't feel that there's a need for a cure. That problem is our sin. It's so bad that the Bible tells us in James chapter 1, verse 15, then when lust has conceived, it brings forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, brings forth death. When we get a sense of just how serious it is that we've actually waged a revolution against God, we will realize how desperate we are in need of the cure to the sin problem, salvation through Jesus Christ, the Son of God. His is the only salvation that will modify your eternal destiny. I want to introduce you to some good news, the gospel. And unfortunately, it has some sharp edges. There's bad news that goes with it. If you do nothing with the bad news and the good news, then your destiny will not be modified. The gospel answers four crucial questions. Who is God? Who made us? And to whom do we answer? That's question one. Question two, what is our problem? In other words, are we in trouble and why? Our third question we'll investigate is, what is God's solution to that problem? Has he acted to save us from it? And the fourth and final question is, how do I, myself, right here, right now, how do I come to be included in that salvation? What makes this good news for me and not just for someone else? Years ago, my wife and I traveled across America and we had a sat-nav, a GPS. It was before the days of being able to have Google Maps or Apple Maps with pinpointed directions. They weren't the greatest, but they were better than what we had before, paper maps. And sometimes I wished that we had been able to go back to the paper maps because I felt maybe in some situations they were a bit more accurate. The maps that were uploaded to our TomTom unit were only partially accurate. Sometimes they contain maps of city planners as they intended the city to grow, and roads that were supposed to be there didn't actually end up being there because the towns didn't grow as they had anticipated. So lo and behold, we drive to XYZ Road and it wasn't there. We were in the middle of nowhere. That happened a number of times when we had given a commitment to be at a location by a certain time and we were lost in the middle of nowhere and we had to retrace our steps. Fortunately, we always had access to satellites. That wasn't the problem, but the problem was sometimes getting to our location or not having a mobile signal to be able to ring ahead and ask, how do we get there? It was frustrating to say the least. We often get led astray through depending on our intentions alone rather than on reality. A reality check for you and for me is that if we are depending on our own intentions to get us to heaven, the end result is that we're lost. Even more serious than being lost is in being in perilous danger of God's wrath to punish sins. That first question, enter God. Who is he? I've read about it. People have asked me about it. Who is God? Which God? Well, it's not the millions of gods of Hinduism and Buddhism. It's the one true God. How can I say that with such authority and with such confidence without being egotistical? He is the Creator God who made us. It is He who's put His badge upon us. Now, we find in the Psalms, it's a book of the Bible that's dedicated to really expressing the human heart. And in Psalm 100, verse number 3, it says, "Know ye that the Lord, He is God. It is He that hath made us, and not we ourselves." You see, there's no such thing as a self-made man. God has made us, and not we ourselves. We didn't bring ourselves into existence. It might be argued, well, our parents brought us into existence, but then who brought them into existence? And their forefathers, all the way to the dawn of creation. Where did we all come from? We all came from that same maker, God. That's why we have similar features. But God and His amazing creativity made us all different. Now, as an automobile manufacturer might make many models, but it's all of the same manufacturer. So we as humans, we're many models, but we have one manufacturer, God. But there's another supposed manufacturer out there. His name is Satan. He's not an actual manufacturer, but he'd like us to make us think that we are our own makers. And so what he does is he tries to peddle to us a false badge. Now, if I were to make a vehicle and put a major manufacturer badge on it and beginning to market it as such, I would get sued because that maker is jealous in a good way of their earnings. They don't want to see their earnings go to something fraudulent. And same is true with God. He has made us, and He doesn't want us to see it. He doesn't want to see us go into a fraudulent direction in a way that claims to be right, but isn't actually right. So the one who's made us is not some cosmic explosion, but the one true God. There is another argument to this, and that is we all came from a cosmic explosion, pure chance. That pure chance leaves us with no purpose for our existence, and therefore we shouldn't act as though life has purpose in our own existence. Now, none of us acts this way, but we all try to think of ourselves in this way, apart from God. Why? Because we like to be the master of our own destinies, which is why in the 1800s, Charles Darwin popularized the idea of evolution, that before this came explosions, out of that came amoebas, out of that eventually came apes, out of that eventually came humans. It gives us no purpose in life other than an accident way back eons ago. Now, there's a major problem to this. The problem is that even the most devout atheist acts in contradiction to their own belief. Even the most devout atheist acts with purpose in life. So even though we might claim that we were a result of a chaotic explosion, we don't actually act like it. Take, for instance, the scramble to find a cure and a vaccination for the COVID-19. Take, for instance, all the tax money that we pay to fund the fire brigades and the rescue services. All that is completely meaningless and frivolous spending if we have no purpose in life, that we came from a cosmic explosion. But it does make sense, and it is not frivolous and money well spent if we do have purpose in life. And that purpose comes from being created by a God who stamped His badge on us, His image upon us. What does that image mean? It means that we think rationally and we're able to think with a sense of right and wrong, with justice, a sense that says this evil deed must be punished and that's a good deed, that person needs to be praised. That's that sense that we have within us that comes straight from God's image in us. And we all come with a degree of that. So whether or not we like to acknowledge that there is an existence of this Creator God and that He has made us and not we ourselves, we're simply lying to ourselves. The other view, aside from chaotic explosions, is that we are created as a result of an idea, a plan, an action of an all-intelligent creator God. Life, therefore, has purpose. Finding a cure, a vaccine for the coronavirus is therefore important. Funding our NHS, funding our fire brigades, funding all these services to help us, the police force, etc., the military, it all has a purpose, and that is to preserve life, because life has meaning and life has purpose. Our problem, and we're usually unaware of it, is that we are involved in a revolution against this creator God. In short, we have rebelled against him. And that is why we're naturally under the wrath of God, because we have rebelled, we have put up our hands against this creator God, and we've said, God, actually, I'm going to be my own destiny finder. I'm calling the shots, not you. I'd rather it be me and not you. Well, Exodus chapter 34, another book in the Bible, verses 6 to 7, tells us about this creator God. He is a loving God, but he is a just God. And we're going to find in these verses a very sharp edge to the gospel. Exodus chapter 34, verses 6 and 7 says, The Lord God is merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth. Now, so far, we like that because it doesn't attack our self-sufficiency. We just think of God as this nice person out there. We're going to go over that in just a moment. But here's the sharpest edge of the gospel. Despite the fact that verse 7, it says, he keeps mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression, he will by no means clear the guilty. He will by no means clear the guilty. In other words, God does remember our sins when they are unforgiven. And he has to deal with those sins, not just as we think of forgiveness to let someone off the hook. Often when a politician asks for forgiveness because they've done something untoward, not every time, but many times, they're simply asking the public, would you please let me off the hook? Instead of having to face up with the consequences. But when we ask forgiveness from God, we can't simply think of, well, I just want to be let off the hook with no consequences. Every sin has a consequence. God's love does not cancel out his justice and his righteousness. Otherwise, that love would be a perverted love. He would love all things, good and evil. And that's a contradiction, a walking contradiction in terms. God's love doesn't cancel out his justice. Rather, it simply emphasizes that out of his hatred for seeing us spend a Christless eternity in hell, he has to deal with our sin. God is not an unscrupulous caretaker or a janitor who might sweep all the dust of our lives, all the iniquities of our lives under the carpet and leave them there as though no one would ever see them. God's not like that. He must deal with our sins. Think of a caretaker who's in a building and sweeps the rubbish under the carpet, all the while unaware that he is under the watch of CCTV with an actual human behind it who's seen everything that caretaker has done. That's very much like God. Even though we don't think he has seen us, he's seen every single offense against his word, against his law that we've ever done, and he must deal with each and every one of them. Our sins of self-righteousness are the chief most sins that separate us from God. We try to lavish excuses on ourselves. We try to say, well, I'm not as bad as, and we point our fingers at someone else or something. Well, let's look at what the Bible says about this excuse of I'm not as bad as. In Romans chapter 1, we find some very disturbing verses that emphasize the sharp edge of the gospel. It says, being filled with all unrighteousness in verse 29, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covetousness, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. In chapter 2, verse 1, we find out the conclusion of all this. Therefore, thou art inexcusable, O man, whosoever thou art that judgest, for wherein thou judgest another, thou condemnest thyself, for thou that judgest doest the same things. So God is saying that we are the ultimate hypocrites as sinners. Because we condemn others, we might condemn the terrorist for the thing that he's done. Meanwhile, we condone the very things that we've done. That's hypocrisy, because both are sin in God's eyes. Different consequences in this life, yes, but they're both sin in God's eyes. And God is saying that we are inexcusable. We're without excuse. Not only has his creation, the animals, the plants, the sky, the seas, the sun, everything, not only does that tell us about our Creator God, and we're without excuse that way, but the law that he's written upon our own hearts, and he rings that alarm bell of our conscience, and he says, that, for that reason, you are inexcusable, without excuse. In fact, sometimes we think of God like this. He's a really nice old man in the back garden. We talk with him every so often, but he's okay with everything I do if I just try my best and don't hurt anybody. He's a low-maintenance friend who doesn't talk back much, but when he does, he usually tries to tell me through some slightly weird sign that what I was going to do anyway is okay with him. Deep down, I know he wishes that I'd be better, you know, more loving, less selfish, all that. But he's realistic. He knows I'm human. Nobody's perfect. He's really okay with me as I am. Now, if you think of God in any of those terms, I'm very sorry, but you're gravely mistaken. It's a mistake that makes you think you're in charge of your own destiny as though you're driving a car, you're behind the wheel, you have no control over the wheel, you have no steering, you have no brakes, you only have the gas. And you hit the gas and you go and you think you're controlling your life, but actually you're careening away from God towards a destiny in hell and the lake of fire. My friend, deep down, each of us knows that hell is a reality, even though if we want to say that hell is a figment of our imagination. Otherwise, and bear with me, you don't hear people telling each other, go to heaven angrily. You only hear people say the opposite, go to, and then they say hell, because they know deep down that it is a place of reality. And if hell is here on the earth, we wouldn't say that. Now, I don't personally say that to anyone, but we would never hear anyone say that if it wasn't a reality, if it wasn't an actual place of torment and flames. Deep down, we all know the truth that hell is a reality, no matter how much we try to dismiss it. The real problem here is that we want God to overlook our sins, but not the terrorist sins or your ex-partner's sins. God, forgive me, but don't you dare forgive him. None of us wants a God who doesn't deal with evil. We just want a God who won't deal with our own evil. I hope your eyes are enlightened after having heard what I've just talked about. And if you have any questions, if you want to enter into a relationship with Jesus Christ, as that's the only way to get to heaven, to have your sins forgiven, please email us and give us the opportunity to chat with you about what it means to know Jesus as your Savior and have your eternal destiny modified for the better. Now remember, if you do nothing with this information, then your destiny is already set. The course is already set. But God doesn't want anyone to perish in hell, but will have all people to come to repentance. God loves you, my friend. Would you email us or contact us through Facebook? Let us know about this decision that you'd like to make or have questions about anything in life. If you have a question about it, we'd love to hear from you. God bless. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more strong.
sins there are many, His mercy is more. What love could remember, no wrongs we have done. Omniscient, all-knowing, He counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. His mercy is more.